Joining us on Hot Copy this morning, we have Energy Secretary Rafael Lotilia. Secretary Lotilia, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen, and good morning to all your listeners.
All right, let's start first with the power outages in general. What is the status first of Luzon? We were on red alert. Are we on yellow alert now? Where are we?
Well, for this week and for us, power demand outlook has indicated, for the months of actually since April, we have been on yellow. The possibility of yellow alert has been there. Mm-hmm. But of course, as you have noted, in April, we didn't have any power interruptions, not even resulting to red alerts. Mm-hmm. And then in May, especially with the high temperatures, there has been the yellow alert became a red alert for Luzon and actually resulted in power interruptions in parts of the island. So the DOE has taken steps to require NGCP to make regular reports and to make sure that the protection systems among the generation plants, the transmission and distribution is the coordination is made. So, and to ensure that there will be no recurrence of the problem. Now, on its part, the NGCP has also pointed out that the ultimate solution would be the transmission, would be finishing transmission upgrade in several parts of Luzon, as well as we have required the NGCP to fast track the contracting of ancillary services. Mm-hmm. You will also recall that previously the Energy Regulatory Commission already approved the competitive selection process for ancillary services. Mm-hmm. And so this is for signing and contracting and for submission to the Energy Regulatory Commission. Mm-hmm. So we want that fast track so that there will be enough reserves.
Okay.
So in other words, the projections that are there is that we would have had sufficient supply even though the reserves were thin, but this particular tripping of the transmission line was not expected and therefore did not figure in the power demand outlook for May. So for as long as we have the Ilihan power plant, which is 1,200 megawatts, mm-hmm. and which has not been been in operation since June of 2022, mm-hmm. then for as long as it is not back in service, then our reserves will necessarily be limited. So we hope that by June, the Ilihan power plant with its LNG fuel will already be online and therefore address much of these constraints. So all our assumptions take into account that there is no additional power from Ilihan. That the constraints, the transmission constraints, which we have been working on with the NGCP since the start of this administration, the scenario also assumes that these will not be addressed yet. So we were based on the reports and representations by NGCP before, these were expected to have been finished by December of 2022. That is the Bataan-Hermosa line, and mm-hmm. therefore would have helped alleviate the tight situation during the hot summer months.
Okay, well, all right. Well, you've gave a very clear summary on that. But first, basic questions is, so are you assuring us that this coming May and June is going to be very hot? Are you assuring us that there will be no more brownouts in the Luzon grid first, in Luzon?
Well, if I were omniscient and all-powerful, Karen, I will give you that assurance. But
all right.
I am, as you know, I am not.
And the reason I'm asking...
Yes, but the probability, given that we actually have, we will have adequate supply once Ilijan is back in operation, then we have really better chances of having a more stable supply in Luzon.
Okay, what are the lapses of NGCP here, if there are any? You talked about a transmission upgrade, and that's going to take a while, but this should have been done years before, if not months before. No less than President Marcos Jr. had called at one time the NGCP to move faster in putting up more transmission lines after what happened in Negros. So first, what are the lapses and the gaps with NGCP?
Well, we have been working since day one of this administration to help out NGCP address a number of things. One is the right-of-way issues that they face. And there were cases that were pending in the courts. And then in coordinating with local government units, because some local government units withheld either a construction permit or a business permit or whatever permit. Mm-hmm. And it's important to stress that all sectors of society, even if the transmission lines merely pass through their territory, mm-hmm. should really assist, because this is a nationwide concern, not merely the concern of a local government unit. The other is, of course, with respect to the landowners. Mm-hmm. So in Negros, we have been facing that problem, and I've been asking both NGCP and the generators whose power is actually being wasted right now. For several years, they have not been able to feed into the grid precisely because the transmission lines are inadequate.
Yeah.
So
are we relying only for NGCP to build all these transmission lines?
Well, right now, the NGCP is the one that under the concession agreement builds, it has the obligation to build the transmission lines, and okay. it's being paid by us.
Yeah, but based on the performance of NGCP, do you believe as Energy Secretary that they are up to the task? Because it's been many years that we've been having this problem. So is NGCP sufficient to build all the transmission lines needed, or should there be, frankly, another contractor, supplier, entity to also build transmission lines?
We of course, from the government's end, we are not satisfied with power interruptions. And mm-hmm. therefore, we want to be able to secure more stable supply by ensuring the rollout of these projects. Now, we are looking at various other alternatives. And we want the cooperation of NGCP here by specifying what are the projects that it can deliver within the time frame that is needed by the country in order to provide adequate supply.
But in effect, NGCP is a monopoly in this business. That's right. A fact. So my question
and the franchise is granted by Congress.
Mm-mm.
So we've got to work with all stakeholders here. Mm-hmm. So Congress is a stakeholder because it granted the franchise under certain conditions. Mm-hmm. And then the regulator is the Energy Regulatory Commission. Mm-hmm. And the DOE coordinates from a planning standpoint.
But given the power problem we are facing in the Philippines, I want to ask you, should NGCP be the only company to build transmission lines in the country?
Well, from an economies of scale perspective, it has been at the start of the privatization of the transmission grid. That was debated, and that there the debate was whether it should government be to run the transmission system or it should be turned over to the private sector. And the arguments then that won was in favor of private sector because one, the flexibility that private sector has.
No, and then Secretary, I'm asking you what you think now. Do you believe that they should be the sole supplier, contractor, builder of our transmission lines?
Yeah, Karen, you it is not easy to answer your question directly. So, for example, in your case, you are saying we will have two transmission operators all over the land. I mean, can you imagine transmission towers that are doubling up in certain parts of the country? No, we have to avoid that kind of a situation because that would impact on the consumers. But if you are saying, is there a possibility for us to explore that new transmission lines or transmission lines that have not been built by the private concessionaire should be built by government or through PPP, then we are considering those particular options.
Okay, all right, interesting point. Now, at one point you had asked the NGCP, the Energy Regulatory Commission denied the request, right, for monthly ancillary service agreements. So the NGCP has cited that reason as one of their problems. What is the status now? Because you did say that DOE said just make a request, but the ERC denied it.
No, the ARC has already told them that they can continue with contracting for ancillary services. And in fact, that's why since NGCP has successfully conducted the competitive selection process for ancillary services, it is now a matter of signing the contract and filing the same contracts with ERC. So I think here again, we need the cooperation of everyone and particularly on the part of NGCP to submit such.
Okay. What would you want the NGCP to act on fast? I mean, it's a given that you would want them to...
Well, finish the three major interconnection systems. One is the Bataan to Hermosa line, which has been promised, which has been delayed already for ages. The Cebu-Negros-Panay interconnection, which has also been delayed for many years. And then the Mindanao-Visayas interconnection. But at the same time, I would like to call upon all the stakeholders, including landowners, local government units, and everyone else, to help facilitate the construction of these very crucial transmission lines. Mm-hmm. But the main responsibility, of course, remains with NGCP. And we will work with them as we have worked with them. But at the same time, we will work with all other government agencies, including Congress, to exact accountability.
Exactly.
These are not incompatible. Working to support them on the things that they need, where they need support, and then working to make them accountable. And the performance reviews are part of this. Unfortunately, the audit that was done by the Energy Regulatory Commission was the first since 2009 when this was privatized. And so we expect that this audit will be followed by a performance review, a contractual performance review by PISAM and Transco, who are the counterparties to the concession agreement, and regulatory performance review by the Energy Regulatory Commission. So I appeal to everyone that in this particular case, we should avoid the conflicts that prevented the conduct of these reviews in the past, because the ultimate goal is to help the country, to help everyone in order to get those lines going. And then, of course, the generators as well. So we hope that the projects that that are online or that are in the pipeline will come online as scheduled.
Okay, some quick questions there, just very quickly, sir, on NGCP before we move to something else. Number one, of the three projects that you had said they should finish, is there a timeline for this? Because they're delayed as it is.
Yes, so they have submitted the latest timelines. And they have been, most of them have been moved to August of this year. But we keep on pushing for an earlier rollout.
Okay, so number two, the last audit with NGCP you said was 2009. After
no,
that,
no. The franchise began in 2009.
Okay,
this
when
is
was
the first audit? Karen.
This is the first audit.
Yes,
there's never been an audit.
No,
there has never been a performance audit of NGCP.
On the part of the Energy Regulatory Commission, unfortunately, over the last 14 years, this is the first that has been conducted. And on the part of PISAM and Transco, there was resistance to having them perform a contractual performance review. Now, that's in the past. So I hope that here we are able to start on new ground, and that we will be able to do this because we want to be able to ascertain exactly where the weak points in the transmission system are and address them.
Mm-hmm.
So as you said, whether it is by NGCP or NGCP working with government or through PPPP, mm-hmm. then we can try the other alternatives where needed.
Okay, my last question on this, given that NGCP technically is a monopoly and the sole provider, if in the performance review they don't fare quite well, of course, somebody has to be held accountable. What then happens? Are the Filipino people stuck, frankly, with no alternative?
No, Karen, Congress also demands accountability from the franchise holders. Mm. And therefore, the final accountability would be to Congress.
Mm. Mm.
So we definitely would have to work with everyone here. The DOE does not have the power to cancel or to transfer the franchise. But we will do it, of course, in accordance with law and explore what the possibilities are.
All right. Now, moving on to the bigger picture, Senator Rafi Tulfo at one point actually deplored the price of energy in the country. He claims that there's been a drop in prices of coal in the global price index. I know that there are no new power plants in the pipeline. Am mm-hmm. I correct there, Secretary?
Well, there are some, but there are a number of plants, whether it's in Luzon, both the coal renewable energy. So there are some, but let me just clarify a number of things. One, the high prices is because we have chosen from the start also not to subsidize. If we compare our prices to Indonesia and Vietnam and Thailand, these are subsidized prices. Mm. So when the Ukraine war, the invasion of Ukraine started, and coal prices and oil prices went up, then we were severely affected by those. But please take note, Karen, that there is still a secondary price cap. And in fact, that secondary price cap, because of that, the prices that we have right now does not fully reflect the true cost of power.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a case where we have to consider all of these things combined. Do we want to subsidize power in the Philippines? In the other countries, their upstream, for example, their coal, or their oil and gas industry is the one that subsidizes the downstream or the power sector. Now, in our case, we do not have the luxury of that option because our Malampaya gas is limited, and then we don't, our coal supply is also limited.
Yeah, yeah. So what are you seeing, Secretary Lutilia, for the country's energy, I would have to say the program in the long term?
Yes.
I think that
is very important. Yeah, that's a very important point, Karen. And that's why the president's program has always been one, that we have to diversify our sources of energy. And because of climate change, we also have to rely on renewable energy. And that's why the targets for a 50% renewable energy by 2040 is an important target. Now, he raised in relation to the energy diplomacy that he has been conducting. Mm-hmm. In fact, he raised the important points with President Biden of the United States. The president pointed out that that countries like the Philippines, because of climate change, has to have access to new technologies which are low carbon and renewable, mm-hmm. and that we need the assistance of the developed countries. So the president brought up the concept of loss and damage. Mm-hmm. That's the concept that there has to be compensation for developing countries which have not contributed or have contributed the least to the climate crisis today. And in his response, President Biden did not skirt the issue or the responsibility. He acknowledged that the responsibility of the United States is precisely to assist the countries that are suffering directly right now from the crisis. And for us, that includes, for example, financing for transmission facilities, for distribution facilities. We need to upgrade because climate change has increased the number of extreme events, including the super typhoons that we have seen in the country. And right now, the extreme high temperatures that our people are experiencing. So, okay. In the development or in upgrading of these facilities, we need the financial and technical know-how.
Okay. All right. So that would be a bonus, what the president has mentioned to President Biden. But I know you also met with some companies. So I wanted to ask you, was nuclear the biggest power solution put on the table? I interviewed Secretary Blinken and he talked about modular nuclear power plants. Mm-hmm. And I know that won't even be operational under President Marcos's time. And it would be a test case because am I right to say there isn't one in the world right now that uses a modular nuclear power plant?
Well, China is supposed to have one. But the important point that you raised is that the president is looking into various alternatives because his concern is, of course, one, for safety. The other one is that these are suitable for the Philippine condition. And then, of course, third, the price. Mm-hmm. And in the United States, too, the presentations, for example, explored new technologies in modular nuclear. Like one was using ceramic to encase uranium pellets, and the president was quite fascinated with the physics part of it. Mm. That here is fissile material that is contained, and the cooling medium is helium. And therefore, it has the probability of an explosion or a meltdown is eliminated. So these are the things. He is looking at different technological solutions. Okay. But what is important is that we are open and we will prepare the groundwork for a decision on this particular part.
Okay. Another question I wanted to ask you is the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant. Congressman Mark Kawanko, I've had him on Head Start a few times. He is an advocate for nuclear. As Energy Secretary, I wanted to ask you, is the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant, frankly, a possibility?
Well, right now, Karen, everything, of course, is possible. But one of the activities that the interagency committee is doing is to examine the potential sites. Mm. And the sites are being assessed in accordance with the standards laid down by the International Atomic Energy Agency. Now, after what happened in Fukushima, the IAEA issued a new set of guidelines on safety and on siting and so on. So our different agencies, including the Philippine PhilVox, the Volcanology Agency, are the ones who are studying this. And since I am only a mere lawyer, I'm not going to pretend that I have expertise on the adequacy or the suitableness of these sites. Okay. But we will listen to them, and as the president has promised, we will be transparent in especially on the scientific reports that will be the basis for any decision.
Okay, so Secretary, let's talk big picture. The president has 6 years, so he's right. About to approach his first year this coming July. And what's important is the energy vision, right, of this administration. So there are already talks, of course, it's been predicted that there will be a looming energy crisis because of the Malampaya natural gas supply, right? Mm-hmm. And the expectation is it's going to be depleted by 2024. So the president has 5 years left, but 2024 is technically a year and a half away, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask you first your medium-term and long-term goals, so that under this administration, it's not remembered as I remember during Fidel Ramos's administration, he was faced, and the latter part of Cory Aquino, faced with nonstop brownouts, blackouts, right, Secretary?
So Karen, absolutely. Right. So okay. From day one, that's why the president has been addressing on the upstream. So Malampaya, what ends in 2024 is not the supply in Malampaya, but the service contract. Mm-hmm. And so that was important to be addressed, and decision on whether to extend the service contract has been with the palace, and we expect that there will be action on this soon. But the medium term and the long term for the upstream, therefore, is to make sure that the policy and legal framework under Presidential Decree 87 remains in place in order to attract the development of the near fields. That is the gas fields within the same service contract as Malampaya, as well as outside of Malampaya. So that has been important for the president. Second, we see, of course, that the process of energy transition is not going to be done overnight. It is going to be over an extended period of time. And that means putting in place alternative sources of power or energy to be used. So one of them is the liquefied natural gas, which is to complement the current supply of Malampaya, because we knew from day one of Malampaya it is a finite resource. It will end at some time. So we should have prepared early on to have a successor fields to Malampaya. But unfortunately, this had to be done by the current administration, and we have been doing our best in order to accelerate the development of the upstream. So LNG will provide the the transitional
fuel.
A transition fuel. Yeah. Well, we can't say exactly when its role will end, but it, since it's also fossil fuel based, if we are to go for low carbon solutions, then eventually it will also have to be replaced by such possible alternatives as ammonia, hydrogen, or nuclear. So these are the things that we will have to look at in terms of diversification. And then the renewable, and on the renewable energy part. Yeah. So that's why the president has ordered that we take a look seriously in following the report that was made on the potential of offshore wind and other offshore technologies, as well as floating solar, that we explore all of these alternatives and move them fast. And again, here, the role of the transmission system is very important, because we need to bring the renewable energy sources into the market. So again, we will have to work with all concerned in order to make sure that there is a timely deployment of the renewable energy.
Okay, Secretary, I know that when it comes to power, power can be completely foreign owned. Am I correct now to say this?
Not in all cases, because we, in the case of hydro, the drawing of water from the source is still 60% required to be Filipino ownership.
Okay.
But renewables, it has been open to foreigners, as well as the generation part.
So, Secretary, what is it then if, because they're talking, of course, there's a lot of talk now about charter change, asking for more foreign direct investments. Given the fact that power generally can be foreign owned, why aren't we seeing more foreigners and investors come in, frankly, to build either more power plants or provide the kind of power that you've just mentioned? What is stopping them? What is really the problem? Is it the ease of doing business in the Philippines? I know that at one point I interviewed someone in Singapore, it just takes 3 days to get a permit, that you can build a power plant. What hasn't improved in our country?
Well, I think, Karen, you have identified some of those problems. The permitting system is more complex here, from the local government units all the way to coming out with their, to the rollout of their operations. So, but what one important thing that President has also stressed is a level playing field. And that is why in this, the Energy Regulatory Commission, which is the regulatory body for the power sector, has an important role to play as well. It's not going to be, its decisions are not going to be arbitrary, that is skewed towards one particular or certain interests, but that all will be treated equally. Second, what you pointed about ease of doing business. So we cannot isolate the power sector from the rest of the economy. So if foreigners or foreign investors are looking at other aspects of the economy and see the same obstacles, then it's the same obstacles that they would expect in the power or energy sector. But that's why what the president has tasked us to do in the case of offshore wind is to make sure that we are coordinated with all of the agencies concerned, and we resolve all the permitting requirements so that the investors can then roll out their projects in a faster way. So we hope to address the backlog, for example, in the system impact study that has to be done by NGCP, because the lag right now is for more than 1 year, some are saying even 2 years. So we will have to find solutions to this within the time frame. And I'm sure that the president, by the time he makes his State of the Nation address, we'll be able to clarify a number of this.
My last question quickly, because I have to wrap it up, is do you have a target in terms of megawatts that you want this administration to be able to provide or add? Because clearly,
Well, there is in the medium-term Philippine Development Plan, there are targets that have been set in terms of the megawatts that have to be above to take into account the reserve requirements. So we will be bound by those targets, Karen. So let's all work to achieve those targets.
All right. On that note, Energy Secretary Rafael Lotilia, I want to thank you for joining me today. I do hope you come back to Head Start, sir, and soon.
Thank you. I just have some jet lag right now, so suffering from it. But yes, we'll get back to you at some point. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you, sir, and good luck. No more brownouts. Thank you.
Yes, we're praying hard for that.
All right. Thank you, sir.